Hi, everyone.
Hi, I am from India's arts capital, Calcutta. It is exactly like Melbourne. We have a lot of artists, but no audience. That's the only problem. I started off doing comedy in Calcutta. After every show, the entire audience would go home in one Uber pool. Driven by me. Because if you have to do comedy in Calcutta, you have to do four other jobs. Otherwise, there's no future. We didn't have the basics right in Calcutta. Like, we did not have theater-style seating for comedy shows so that the audience is focused towards the stage. We didn't have it. Because if we had row-wise seating over there, people from the back rows used to fuck off quietly. Thinking no one will notice. People in the front have no idea that they are all alone. I remember I was doing a show and a few minutes into the show, a couple walked off. And I was like, yeah, this is every day. This is okay. But then something weird happened that night. After 15 minutes, they came back. I was like, this is the game-changing moment. They have realized their mistake. They have come back to support live comedy. But then they were like, no, we forgot our umbrella. Then they again fucked up. I used to run a Friday night comedy room over there, okay? And it was a great room. It was in a great location. But the problem I faced was the maximum audience count and the minimum audience count was the same. Two. This went on for years. After which, they broke up. Now there's one person. And when you're one person at a comedy show, you don't know whether he's come to watch you or you've come to watch him. After a while, he told me that he comes to comedy shows because he wants to be a comic. And I'm like, I've lost whatever little respect I had. So now, then I moved cities. So I don't live in Kolkata anymore. I used to work in the corporate sector and I quit my job a few years back, not because of stand-up. I quit because I had just one day of the week off. Just one day, which was a Sunday. And HR used to organize picnics on that day. On my only day off, there is employee engagement. My weekend is gone. My weekend is gone. I report to office on a Monday. The same HR has now organized a motivational session to help me get through the week. And I don't understand why corporations have motivational sessions. Because when employees get motivated, they quit. Why are you funding your own demise? You know, this is like showing a prisoner a tunnel. I don't know whether you have motivational sessions in offices over here, but in India, it's a huge business, okay? It's a very lucrative business. I did some calculations. This guy who used to come to my office, he was paid roughly about 10,000 Australian dollars per session to motivate me. And I'm like, if you have to motivate people and you have a budget, the solution is right there. Distribution. Because money is a bigger motivator, right? This guy was great. He used to take our numbers and then send us inspirational quotes at night, okay? He was very, very serious about his job. He used to inspire us without our consent, okay? He used to just send us messages. And those quotes weren't even from Google, okay? He used to make them up himself. So that's low-grade motivation I'm getting. You can't get motivated when you spot a spelling error. Like, you know, it's... He used to send me messages early in the morning, messages like, Anirban, remember, you are a winner. And I'm thinking, what game was I playing last night, dude? Waking up to that message is the biggest defeat of my life, okay? He was obsessed with the term winning because he never experienced it, okay? So he used to be like, Anirban, remember, you're born to win. And I'm like, no, we are all born to die. Everybody knows this. Because in life, you don't win all the time, right? In life, you win some, you lose some. For example, you win inheritance, you lose your dad. That's a great reaction. I can't do this joke in India, guys. Please let me do it here. Because in comedy shows in India, they come with their dads over there. So I can't. I've been married for 6 years now, and I don't have a kid, which is a crime in India. And everybody's demanding kids out of me. They're demanding. They're not expecting. They're not anticipating. They're not hoping. They're straight away like, why no kids? And I'm like, you look in front, man. You're my Uber driver. Like, why? Why are you interested? Have you met these Uber drivers who are super chatty? Yeah? Like, they want to be friendly, but sometimes it's the wrong place, right? It's the wrong place at the wrong time. I remember I was on a cab ride, and this guy is asking me all sorts of philosophical questions. He's very enthusiastic. He wants to have a conversation on philosophy. He's asking me things like, where do you want to go? And I'm like, right. He's like, where do you see yourself in 5 years? And then he asked me, what do you do for a living? I say comedian, that's the end of the conversation. All his enthusiasm has vanished. Now there's awkward silence. And I am under pressure to break this silence. And all I managed to say is, what about you? Somebody got it now? Okay. me and my wife, we've been together for 10 years now, and we are currently great roommates, and we have our own set of problems and keys. It's all different. Like, my big problem, like I said, I don't want to have a kid. My wife, on the other hand, she has a completely different problem. Her big problem is she hates her boss. And she hates her boss so much that to avoid her for a while, she wants to take maternity leave. Now, in this fight between she and her boss, how am I the loser? I'm not even working at her office. I'm losing fights I'm not even part of. And the motivational speaker is like, you are a winner. Not adding up at all. My mom is putting a lot of pressure on me. And, you know, whenever I tell my family that, listen, I don't want to have a kid, whenever I tell my wife I don't want to have a kid, she's very dismissive. She's like, don't irritate. When I want it, I'll get it done. Well, how do I not have any control over this? Because every time I'm having sex with her right now, I don't know whether it's for business or pleasure, okay? Even my friends who have no stake in my kid, even they are putting pressure on me. My friend from college, my best friend from college, she calls me up and she's like, listen, it's been 6 years. You're married. You must have a kid. I'm like, must is inappropriate here. What do you mean must? Like, why are you interested? Are you going to get a commission if I have a kid? Why? And she's like, no, having a baby is the logical progression to a marriage. To which I replied, I'll get back to you. Then I called her after about 4-5 months, and she's telling me that she is getting divorced. And I'm like, that's the logical progression to a marriage, okay? And she told me a fascinating story. She told me that not only is she getting divorced, she's also pregnant at that time. And I was like, okay, this is a unique situation. So what happened? And she's like, this is exactly what I want. I want the baby, not the husband. So I want to get divorced. I want to keep the baby and not wake up to this fuck-all face for the rest of my life. He has no feelings. I was like, that's great. That's good for you. If you are happy, congratulations. But now she has delivered a son who looks exactly like the husband. She has to breastfeed that fuck-all face. You know who doesn't care about her feelings? Her husband and genetics, all right? Oh yeah, that's my time. Thank you so much for listening.